Friends, family of all men, I was asked by the University of Indonesia to express a last respect to Ben Anderson. Actually, the University of Indonesia should be represented by two deans that came yesterday, but they could not come to give the speech. So, during the new order, when Ben was banned from coming to Indonesia, of course, we understand that sometimes he felt disappointed with the works of some Indonesian academia that did not show critical attitude toward our church. But one thing to be sure is he never lost hope for the young people. So whenever we invite him to come to the university, whether it's University of Indonesia, University of Erlangga, University of Dharmantara, he always is ready to talk. He was ready to talk to young people. And sometimes with one condition: please do not publicize my visit. But the last event, the launching of the book, well, we could not afford to do that. And thanks to Ronnie Agustinus, who actually facilitated his visit to University of Indonesia. The Faculty of Humanities was very, very honored to have his last lecture, public lecture, there. And I would like to share some of the experience during the lecture. And maybe you can help me. So initially, the lecture was going to be held in an auditorium that can accommodate around 200 people. But there were so many young people, students from all over the campus, outside the campus, people from the media, all corners, wanted to join that. So we had to move it to another place which can accommodate bigger audience, about 400 people. But still it is full pack. A lot of people could not enter. And in that lecture, last lecture, he showed what you have shared this morning. You know, his passion as a scholar and also his passion for young people. He was at that time already looked rather tired, but he never showed any less. You know, he is always excited. He was very excited in his speech and also in his attitude toward young people. Yoyo, maybe you can share some of the scenes in that question. During his the question and answer, a lot of young students raised their hands and they asked silly, ignorant questions. As a scholar in that stature, you know, you would feel very irritated, maybe, or, you know, with that kind of question. But no, Oben was very, very patient. Very, with smile, you know, with his smile, he entertained the question and answered in a very, very succinct and clear way. Can you give me some?
Luckily, I mean, for the family, for worry, and also friends. Actually, I got the whole sound record of the whole lecture, so it would be good actually to listen to the next time. But, following what Magdalene said, one of the spectacular questions is about what the subject of anarchism, and somebody asked very seriously, and then asked, what about the Islamic State of Iraq and Syria? I mean, in a sense, this sort of also punishing people. Would it be able to be categorized as an ultra anarchism and all that, and Ben was trying hard to, you know, conceal the smile and all that, and then finally he said that there is where it's possible. Well, the name is mistake, first of all, and then and anarchist, and then he made quick comparisons with the 19th century anarchisms, where after all this executions of SARS and all that, they didn't run. They just submit themselves to the authorities, and then here I am, just kill us. already done my documentary on it. And anarchists don't run around killing babies and all that. So, and this kind of things. But one other thing is actually about his surface, the unfeeling surface to the young people is the long queue is almost like a wedding ceremony in Japanese Indonesia. It's like probably 200 people, young people queuing for an autograph. And he would listen to one by one and ask him, what's the name again? Husby, how do you spell it? And afterwards, somebody would ask, there's another friend, and he asked, why do you give the word salam? And afterwards, everyone asked a picture with him. It's my life this, and so it's very tiring. I think, if I'm not mistaken, I was with Edwin and Patrick and all that in the back, and probably around 2 hours, full 2 hours, and he diligently did all this. And so it's very touching, actually, to see him, and just, and also the spirit, he just last things, he's going to get out of the room, and then there's a few stairs, and then he used the, you know, the walking stick, and then I told him, and well, this is actually the decision, be careful with your steps and all that, so if you go to Chandi and all that, and probably he feel irritated by this silly advice, and I said, can you hold the cane and survive? And then he ran around the lobby like 2 or 3 times, and then to show, you think, you know, I'm open, no. So this is actually the last memory, last memory from him.
Another question from a young scholar, a young student. That is, I still remember the question and his answer. It is very touching. This is question about nationality. This student, we can say she was confused. What to do with nationality? You know, because it's still very strong. But Ben said that we should be critical about what to do. What kind of nationality should we adopt? You know, and Ben, I still remember it very strongly. Well, I cannot repeat his words exactly, but this is something like this. When I was young, about 8 years old, my mom used to accompany me to school or to the public places and talk with people, you know. And sometimes when I heard my mother speak, I felt completely embarrassed of what she said. I felt like I want to disappear or run away, or, you know, I felt a bit irritated with by the way my mother talked or what she said. But, well, she is my mother. What can you do? You love your mother, and you cannot be separated from your mother. You are always attached. So he said, so the kind of attitude for you towards nationalism is be embarrassed. So maybe you should call this word embarrassed nationalism. As a new theory, right? Another thing, when during the queue, there's a young freshman who never read his work at all, nor heard his name. She was just just happened to be there and listened to his speech. And she, about 20 years old, still very naive, came to him. And she was impressed by the way he started his performance lecture. Because he wore this shirt called Nyeh, and he would stand in the he stood in front of the auditorium and said, ah, screaming, a kind of very growling sound. He said, this is a scream of a frustrated baby. This is the radical feeling of frustration against capitalism or whatever. That is the sound. So this young student, you know, just got this and then came to him and very naively said, when I am an aspiring writer, she never wrote anything, I was very touched and inspired by your speech today. Can I quote them for my short story? I would like to write a science fiction. And Ben said, so I would be a character? Yeah, you would be a character. What the young writer. And on the day of his death, I received a short story. It's about Ombeni. And in that short story, it is a planet called Sparkle, in which a creature can be cloned. And there are different creatures with three legs, gender, or so many different kinds of creatures. And there is one creature called Ombeni. And among other creatures, this Ombeni cannot be cloned. He could speak so many languages. He hops from one tree or another. It's like a sloth mammal, you know, bit, but very mobile and very wise. And this Ombeni always have the sound like that to scare bullies, you know. The writer happened to be somebody who was being bullied because of their sexuality. And he said in the story, there is a young child with transgender or multi-gendered identity who's always bullied. And then Ombeni found this child and then scared the bully with that. And then spoke a curse word in Indonesian. The story is in English. And then the bully said, "What's that? You know, what's that? That's Indonesian. You know, it's to scare bullies." That's it. The bully is the Indonesian is full of the F word, you know, something like that. And then in the end of the story, the young kid is comforted and being cuddled by Ombeni, and then comforted that you are strong, you can survive. And then when she or he woke up, Ombeni disappeared. But he or she felt empowered. So this is the story of a young person that never heard of his name, but was empowered, definitely caught the spirit of his speech, that he was for the marginalized, etc. So we all already expressed our fear from different sorts of the world. Of course, we understand he cannot be killed. As a scholar, he is a very unique scholar that did not only have a big concepts, but he practiced his theory in every moment of his life, and he touched all sorts of people, you know, all people from all walks of life. He greeted the pizza driver the same way as he greeted the dean. He joked with everybody. He was kind to young people. So he was really a scholar. He cannot be cloned, but he could inspire us, and all especially the young people. And one of our friends wrote in the Facebook when he heard about Ombeni passing away, "Part of me died with him. Part of him lives. A part of him lives in me." So I'm sure we will end this not with sadness and tears, but with hope for the future, because he believes in young people and believes in social transformation. So we are sure that Ombeni now laughs at us, smiles at us, you know, finds it a little bit ridiculous of all these fancy things being under his name. But we are sure that his ideas, his whatever, the seeds of love that he has already sown to us, how he touched our life, changed our life, that will continue to live in different ways, to be digested differently, to be transformed, to be adapted to new environment, probably generating new theories, new activism, and new solidarity. Thank you, Ombeni, from all the friends and the world. You will live with us.
Banyak orang di hari terakhir di UI, ceramah Ombeni terakhir yang luar biasa sekali. Kita akan mulai dengan prosesi doa bersama untuk Ombeni.
Sampaikan kepada syukur pada Anda yang terbaik, kepada Anda dan Imam, Bapak Atal, Bapak Bunda, Bapak Bunda.